Spotlight. I'm your host, Wallace Garner III, and we're here with my good friend, Dwight Chatman, a.k.a. DJ KAOS. How you doing, buddy?
I'm doing pretty good. How about yourself?
I can't complain. I can't complain. It's an honor to have you here.
It's a pleasure to be here.
You are born and raised in Louisville?
Correct.
What part of town?
Ooh, let's see. That would be the West End.
The best in.
The best in.
The best in.
Okay. More so Village West, to be exact.
Village West.
Yeah.
Okay.
Way in the West. All right.
I recall when Village West was first built. Yeah. Were you there? Were you inhabiting there then?
I was phase three resident.
Phase, what did that mean?
Well, that was, they had phases. You have phase, I don't know where it started, but I think it ended somewhere around four, or five, seven. I don't know, but I lived in phase three, which is a quaint little townhouse, as I would like to refer to it back then.
Bungalow?
Yeah, that. And I learned a lot. I learned a lot of lessons in the West.
Did you attend Central High School?
I did not attend Central. I was a kid that was bounced around a lot. So by the time I got to high school, I actually went to PRP and J-Town.
And J-Town. So you got caught up in the busing thing.
Yeah. My mother bused me from Louisville to Detroit back.
Wow.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about Detroit. Did you spend a lot of time there?
I spent 4 years there. They were my teen years, so
okay.
It was real transitional, and that was in the 80s. That's when drugs came on the scene in Chicago. It was rough.
When did DJ KAOS become?
DJ KAOS actually became chaotic in Detroit as well. He kind of came back to Louisville. Was a vehicle that kind of kept me from falling in the gaps of going too far along the wrong route.
And so music pretty much, being a DJ, pretty much saved your life, if that'd be safe to say.
Yes, sir. Okay. Definitely.
I know that you and I, we talk quite often, and we're pretty couple spiritual guys, you know.
Yeah.
There's not too many DJs out there that think like us as far as letting the spirit lead us, you know.
Come on,
so,
man. Yeah.
That's a good thing to find someone else like that. Most of the DJ friends I have, you know, they're, like you said a moment ago,
either too far to the left,
right,
too far to the right.
Right, right.
And I guess you gotta know that middle. You know, you gotta be able to know who you believe in,
right,
but still be able to do what you love to do.
Well, who were your early influences?
Early influences for me, DJ realm, DJ wise, would be like Jazzy Jeff.
Okay.
Kid Capri's and all the big New York DJs.
Right.
But here in Louisville,
right,
this guy named Joe Soul.
I remember Joe Soul.
Joe's music ball, he had a big record store.
Right.
And then guy took me under his wing, man, and gave me turntables and said, "Here, man, you were born to do this.
Wow.
You gotta get it." And
Joe Soul.
Joe
Soul. Hadn't heard that name in a long, long time.
He's an awesome guy.
If I remember correctly, did he work at WLU?
I think he may have, but most of his energies went into the record stores.
Right.
Joe's Music Box.
I remember the one over on Oak. They had one over on
15th and Oak.
Yes.
But the very first one was in the Big A Shopping Center.
I remember that.
Yeah. That's when we had the boxing gym across the hall.
Right.
It's been around for a long time.
Right.
Yeah.
You can go, you could DJ and then go over there and fight.
That's right. Either way. You better learn how to fight if you was going to be a DJ.
Right.
Yeah. It's tough.
How has the time from the time you started to now, what have been some of the changes in, and I know there have been monster changes, some of the changes in as far as spinning records?
No, it's very seldom spinning records, but selecting records.
Right.
Because it's a laptop. It's automated. Where DJs, you used to look forward to going buying the latest 45 or LP or whatever, vinyl record.
Right.
Now it's MP3 downloads, and any and everybody can be a DJ. You can decide tomorrow, I want to be a DJ,
right,
and go collect somebody's music files, and pow,
wow,
you're out
wow
there. So
that's,
digital is what's been a big difference.
Mm. Yeah, so everybody can be a DJ now, but you came up in the time where you had to have skills.
Yeah, that and a gifting, because you have to be called in order to stay in any position for 10, 20, 30 years or better.
Right.
It's more than what they say, it's not just in a job, It's an adventure.
And speaking of adventure, we're going to talk about that adventure after we come back. So you hold that note.
Yes, sir.
We'll be back with more Artist Spotlight in a moment.
Watch me. Told you once. Hey, yeah, yeah, yeah. I got something that makes me want to shout. And I got that thing. Tell me what it's all about. Built in vibes. Cause I do my thing. I don't need nobody else. Feel so good, good God. Then I jump back. Hey. Can I kiss myself? Yeah. Oh, oh. Ah. I got soul.
Yeah.
And I'm super bad. Yeah.
We're back with Artist Spotlight. I'm your host, Wallace Gardner III. And we're here with Dwight Chatman, a.k.a. DJ KAOS.
Hey.
On the road again.
Yes.
And speaking of influences and on the road, you said that you perfected, maybe, perhaps, perfected the talent in Detroit. Tell me about the name KAOS. How did that come about?
KAOS came about from the show Inspector Gadget.
No.
When I got home many days at home alone, I would rush home and turn on Inspector Gadget, and he was always fighting the evil genius, KAOS. You know what I mean? So, it stuck with me.
Seriously?
And on top of it being KAOS, I needed something that looked good when I wrote it on my records.
Right.
So, in Detroit, all the DJs would write their name on the records.
Mm-hmm.
So I needed something that looked just as cool.
Right.
Now, I spelled the C-H-A-O-S, that didn't look too cool going around my records because I needed something going around the O.
Right.
So I put K-A-O-S. And it just fit perfectly. So I stuck with it, man.
Inspector Gadget.
Mm-hmm.
When I first, I wouldn't have given you that.
Okay.
If someone had asked me
mm-hmm.
where KAOS, so I was going to go from Get Smart.
Yeah. Well, you know, as I grew a little bit
further, you got, okay.
Get Smart was also one of my favorite shows.
And, you know, they had the criminals with KAOS.
With KAOS.
Right.
KAOS must have been paid to do this. We got to stop it.
Right.
That's what they were saying.
Yeah.
That was KAOS, but when I grew a little further and started to mature a little bit more, I never understood why I had a habit of spelling things differently. One day I was sitting in the park, and I prayed, and I said, Lord, I can't seem to get things right. Why did I spell it KAOS? And he showed me it was never about you. It was always about me. K stands for King.
Hello.
A stands for Alpha.
Right.
O stands for Omega. S stands for Satan.
The beginning and the end, huh?
From where on,
there you go.
Yeah.
I can see it. I can see it now. Tell us about, we were talking backstage, and you were talking about these 45s.
Ooh.
Tell us about these, you know, I'm from a 45 era, where you flip it over, and the other side, lots of times, is better than the hit, so-called
mm-hmm.
hit.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. It was up to you.
You stack them all, and they fall down, one at a time. And when your turntable was messed up, they all fall,
mm-hmm.
hit the needle, and the needle go crazy.
It was bad.
Yeah.
So what I want to do, what I like to do, is I travel all over the world. And because of digital, in the digital age, I kind of fell out of my love for DJing.
Right.
Wow. It became a job more so than my passion and my hobby.
Absolutely.
But what happened was, I started realizing, sometimes you gotta get back to your roots, to the basics, in order to fall in love again. I started adapting this love for 45s.
Right.
DJs in New York, Chicago, all over the world, wherever I travel. Guys go in these little dark places, and they get together and just play 45 records.
Kind of like underground rappers,
that's exactly
right?
What it is. Mm-hmm. Exactly. It's getting back to the roots, the foundation of feeling good. Because vinyl had a feel to it.
Yeah.
Digital
inch,
feels the same.
It's 12 inch, right?
Yeah, like wax had a certain warmth to it.
Right.
And where you heard a record with the snap and the crackle and the
pop. Certain.
Put on a James Brown record.
Absolutely.
Compared to a Lil Wayne record.
Yeah.
You're going to feel so different. You know what I'm talking about? So
electricity.
Yeah.
Literally
yeah.
And figuratively. Yeah.
What you said. So we're trying to, I want to get back into the essence of music and feeling good and
right.
What music is made to do, you know, emotions and things.
Right. And speaking of traveling, who have you been out there with?
Whew. most known for being around Slick Rick. Old pioneer rapper. Wears a lot of gold and a patch and the inventor of storytelling and blending.
Right.
From there, every hip-hop pioneer you can name, from Dana Dane to Salt and Pepper to Rakim to Chubb Rock, Special Ed to Kwame, Houdini, Markey, all of these guys, like, they pretty much accepted me.
So you still go out with them, right? So how does this work? Like, you're home here in Louisville and you get the call?
It's like being in the military. When they call, you come.
Pack your stuff.
Right. Yeah, and it's not for the faint of heart.
Right.
But what job do you have?
There you go.
I get to do something I love to do. I get to touch a lot of people. Right. I meet a lot of interesting people, so I count it all a joy. And again, my job. Music's only half the job.
Right.
My job is to bring God everywhere I go.
There you go.
In the simplest form.
And speaking of wherever you go, looking back at influence, we talked about influences from Detroit, Kid Capri, and Capri Sun drink.
Kool-Aid.
Yeah, Kool-Aid. Hey, Kool-Aid. So, how about here in Louisville?
Here in Louisville, man, I give a lot of respect and props and credit to a group named Player. They had a big song called Cheers to You and had a major album. They were one of the first R&B artists to sign with a major label, Def Jam. So I got a call from Static, Stephen Garrett, kind of missed the song. And he said, man, would you go out on the road with us for promoting your album? I said, yeah, well, why not?
Right,
sure, yeah. Going out on the road with them, we would have a tour bus. And we had to do a 17-city tour.
Wow.
Well, I was the guy in the front of the bus, the bus driver.
Right.
With a Bible.
Oh.
Everybody else was in the back, you know, pumped about being on this tour bus. And, but I would always sit in the front and read the Proverbs.
Right.
I had this thirst for God. So right. I would read. And people would tease me and be like, man, he's up front reading the Bible. You know he's up there. What they didn't know is, along with reading the Bible, I was trying to keep the bus driver woke.
Right.
So we made it safely wherever we went.
Yeah, so it was twofold. And I remember just being that guy, always carrying my Bibles. Like, I never wanted to go nowhere without a Bible.
Right.
Because that's what continues to help me go and do the things I do.
Right, right. And there's many who have gotten that support without the Bible and think they're doing it on their own.
Oh man.
They're never doing it on their own.
Yeah. And I think he showed me at an early age, the more I lift him up, the higher he'll lift me up. To lift him up. So it's like a stir step thing.
Well, let me ask this question. And I don't know if you've ever been asked this or not. We talked about your influences. Is there anybody that you influence that you think of?
Man, that's a good question.
I'm sure you have.
I'm just gonna say,
you just may not know of it.
And if my mind forgets, charge it to my mind, not my heart.
Okay.
There's a few guys here. There's a DJ DS, DJ EB, and DJ. We have a group of young DJs that are coming up that are taking over the clubs. That are doing phenomenal jobs, and they call me on the regular. So, and they say I inspire them or whatever.
Right.
But I don't see myself as that guy.
Well, look at it this way. Someone inspired you and they probably didn't see themselves as that guy either. Well, actually, I want to talk to you about mixing.
You some DJ
mixing. I want to talk to you about mixing because I understand you went to New York.
Mm-hmm.
We talked right before you went to New York.
All right, that's right.
You went to New York to... do some mixing. We're not talking about zip, zip, zip. We're talking about final mix down on albums.
Mm-hmm.
And I won't tell us about that because that's
I went to New York on faith, first and foremost.
Right.
Red
I remember when you left.
Had the hardest time leaving, but faith is the evidence of things hoped for but not yet seen.
Right.
I knew I wanted to be like these guys. I knew I wanted to be one of the top DJs.
Right.
In Louisville, Kentucky, I just couldn't get it.
Right.
Reached the glass ceiling.
Absolutely.
So if you want something different,
you gotta hit the road.
Okay. So I went to New York on faith. Learned about SAE, which is School of Audio Engineering.
Mm-hmm.
Took a few classes. took a few classes. But what I never was good at was school. Mm-hmm. I always had a hard time in organized learning. Okay. Anything organized.
Structured.
Yeah, chaos has a problem with it.
Yeah, that, so that what do I do? And structure, they right. don't go together for too much. Either.
So I take the books that I get from this class, mm-hmm. and I study day and night.
Right.
Day and night. And before you know it, I'm recording audio. Whenever Slickrick does a feature, they're flattering me to record his vocals.
Okay.
Send it to the record labels.
Okay.
They'll send me back a final product. Give my approval that it's okay. You send it back to the label. They cut checks.
Oh, that's a good thing. They cut checks.
Yeah. Yes, that's a beautiful thing like that. Yeah. But let me
make this clear.
They cut checks to the artist.
Oh, okay.
And then the artist
cuts checks.
Say, yeah, here's a little something. Here's a little something. But I appreciate it because, again, I get to do something that I love to do.
That you love.
And I get to provide for the family. So I think the joy and the key to life is doing something that you love. Being able to provide for your family. Being healthy.
Right.
And giving God the glory for whatever it is.
Always.
You do.
Always.
Ooh.
Always.
Is that a mouthful?
We're going to finish with that.
All right.
We're going to start with it.
All right.
Once again, my good friend, Dwight Chatman, a.k.a. DJ KAOS, right here on the Artist Spotlight. Great having you, brother.
Great being here. Thank you.
Spotlight. I'm your host, Wallace Garner III, and we're here with poet, playwright, mother, wife, Neicey Ford-Chatman. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing wonderful today. Doing wonderful. Great to have you on the show. You've got a lot going on. We're going to get right to it right away. We're going to start with what's going on now. You have a play coming October 5th?
October 5th at the Clifton Center here in Louisville. It's located on Payne Street.
Yes. And tell us about the play.
The play is about a young man named Terrence whose life is mimicked off of Job. He loses his father, his wife and daughter, and he starts to blame God and lose his faith. So just when he thinks that he's about to receive his breakthrough because like God robs him again.
Robs him again. That's taken straight from the Bible, seems like, right? Who's starring in the play?
We have a phenomenal singer. She's known around town. She'll rounce. She plays the mother.
Right.
Shane Antonio, who's also a local Louisville singer, he plays the son, Terrence Allen. Mm-hmm. We have LaShawn Daniel, who's a Christian singer from Louisville.
Right.
Some of the other stars are Trina Porter. We have Yvette Allen, Reginald Johnson, Kelvin Wilson, Senior.
Right.
There's quite a few.
Okay. How many total plays have you put on?
Here in Louisville,
Total, everywhere.
Four.
Yeah. And are any of these plays taken from any of the books you've written?
No, they're all...
Just gave you an idea,
yes.
Haven't I?
No.
just gave you that?
The plays were actually... I'm going to say they were inspired by God because, for instance, the first play that I did was called God Only Knows, and I was sitting at home, and a song just popped in my head, and then all of a sudden these words just started coming, like dialogue,
right.
And that was how that first play came about. So all of them have a message, and it's nothing from a book. I couldn't put this in a book if I tried, you know?
Well, you have the book, so someone else will probably buy the rights and do a screen, or maybe a play from the book.
Yeah.
Because you seems like you're covering all angles. You have the books, you have the plays, you know, so, hey, there it is right there. You're going to sell the play, sell the books. Hit Broadway with the plays. There you go.
Well, we might need you to act in one, so you stay on, you know, be on call.
I'll do a voiceover.
Yeah, a voiceover.
Yeah, let me be God in the next one.
Neicey.
You're going
to be talking to me. I'm listening.
But let's talk about Let's go back a little bit now. Originally from Louisville. And you moved.
Yes.
To
twice.
In and out.
The first time I moved to Atlanta.
Atlanta.
Moved back. Worked here for about 3 more years.
Okay.
And then moved to Indianapolis. Okay. And then moved back.
How was that experience? How can you compare Atlanta and Indianapolis a little bit? How?
Atlanta and Indianapolis are somewhat the same. Mm-hmm. They're both big cities. They both have a lot going on.
Right.
Both much faster pace than Louisville. If I had to choose, I would probably choose Atlanta over Indianapolis because Indianapolis is so cold.
Right. Well, they tell me that what really makes a city is the arts.
Yes.
You know, regardless of how large the city is, it's, if you could do something Monday through Sunday,
yes,
it's about the arts.
Well, you can definitely do that in Atlanta.
Yes.
Not so much Indianapolis.
Right.
And everything. If memory serves me correctly, they shut down much earlier in Indianapolis.
And let's talk a little bit about your first book.
Okay.
And was the first book you just mentioned a moment ago? Was that the first book?
First book is Eluding Karma.
Eluding Karma. And tell us about that. Okay. What inspired that and who's Karma? And
right.
Oh, it's Karma a person? You know, sometimes Karma can be a person.
Karma
can be a bunch of people.
Yeah. Karma, the whole Eluding Karma thing is basically what goes around comes back around.
Right.
The whole motto or the whole storyline was you can't do someone wrong and expect to get away with it. Like, even if that person doesn't repay you for your wrongs,
right,
like God or, you know, will come back and repay you.
Right. So the adage when people pray to God, they expect an answer immediately, and it's kind of like eluding karma. Nothing may not happen to them immediately, but it always happens. So when those pray to God for something and they don't hear anything right away, they think he's not listening, mm-hmm, not paying attention, and he's always right on time.
Yeah,
and karma seems to be right on time also.
It's so true, but some people don't wait for that. They don't wait for the whole vengeance is mine. They,
right,
they want to repay what they want to repay when they want to repay it. So,
do you have a favorite book?
Out of the ones that I've written?
Yes.
Yes. That would have to be the last one that I wrote called All I Want Is Forever.
All I Want Is Forever. Mm-hmm. That has a ring to it. It's like a song.
Yeah, actually it is.
I knew that.
Regina Bill, I think.
Really?
I think.
I was going to give you credit for it.
No, like really.
Okay. Did that inspire it?
No.
Okay.
I only know that that's a song because I Googled the title.
Right.
And it came up.
You were looking for your book.
It came up Regina Bill. And I'm like, dang.
She didn't write that.
Yeah, I'm like, dang. Like, but yeah, so it is.
Now, what would have been worse if you heard from Regina Bell? Okay.
You stole mine.
Right. Well, I mean, you could take her song and write a book out of it, and, you know.
I could. Well, the thing about that is you can use titles. Titles can't be copywritten.
Absolutely.
The lyrics, the content, that stuff can, but I can steal any title. But.
And speaking of stealing titles, we're gonna be right back with more Artist Spotlight.
Like Sugar Avery, I think maybe God's trying to tell you something.
Well,
going on, but I would sure like to think that you call on the name of Jesus. Who, Lord? The power that is in that name.
Yes, when the Lord comes through, he comes through right on time.
Yes.
When the Lord comes through, he comes through right on time.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Lord. Right.
So many open doors.
A brand new blessing. Oh,
Neicey Ford-Chatman, and she's just done everything in such a young life, and I'm sure there's a lot more to be done. We talked about stealing titles, though it's not really stealing titles. No one actually invented words that we use now, that we all use, you know. And you actually wrote a book, and it just happened to be a song title. And I'm sure with your talent, you're going to write other books where other people have song titles. So that's not theft. That's smart.
Right. Well, I will say, like, the first book, Eluding Karma, had a different title.
Right.
And before I could publish it, someone else actually published the book with that same title.
Wow.
So I didn't use the title because of that reason.
Did they have the same...
I didn't read it.
Okay.
I should have, but I just didn't read it. Once I saw the title, it was just like, So, yeah.
It may probably, it's not too many, I guess there's some other things you could say, eluding karma, you know, depending on the subject matter, you know, and that's pretty broad-based. On your, you said your favorite book. How about your favorite play that you've written?
The favorite play is the one that we're getting ready to do in October, called God Blocked It.
Okay.
And I wrote that in 2010.
Okay.
We did the first production in 2010. It was such a success.
Where?
People were at the Clifton Center.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. It was such a success. People wanted it back again.
Right.
So we're doing a second showing of it.
Okay.
Or a second production.
Okay.
In October.
I'm sure every playwright and every director, producer would like to take the show on the road. Have you really given that some serious thought and trying to make that happen?
I haven't given it serious thought. I would love for it to happen.
Mm-hmm. What would it take?
Sponsors.
Okay.
It would take a lot, I think, because we would have to make sure that the cast
right.
would be
available
to do those dates, because
right.
once you work with a cast of people who
right.
know each other and get comfortable with each other in their roles,
right.
then that's really a big thing.
Right.
And it's kind of like putting pieces of puzzles together, because
right.
they're so intricate by themselves, but they fit together so perfectly.
Right.
They become a family, and to go from one place to another and even recast,
mm-hmm.
I don't think it would gel as good as
recasting can be tough right there. And that kind of gives you a lot of respect for people that travel plays,
right.
that go on Broadway, the Tyler Perry plays that he travels with. Movies?
I would love to. If I were to, the book that I would like to do the movie off of would be All I Want Is Forever. Eluding Karma would be the second.
All I Want Is Forever is a good title of the movie. That's one of those, sounds like an Oscar.
I'm playing it.
Sounds like
I receive it.
How are you as a director? Are you a taskmaster?
No, but I do.
You said that pretty quick. Now, I haven't met any directors that just sit back, you know, like they're Martin Scorsese or something like that.
Well, I have those moments where I get to that point where I have to buckle down and be like, hey, like, we're on time.
Right.
You know, we have a time limit. We have to
right.
keep moving. We have to stay on task.
Right.
That's only happened once so far.
Oh.
Yeah, it was pretty bad. Not bad at all.
Yo, I see the look in your eye. And you tipped me off, and the audience wants to know. Tell us about it. You don't have to call names.
It wasn't bad.
You can
at all.
Tell me names afterwards.
Well, it was just one of those. When we get too playful during a rehearsal.
Right, right.
And like I said, when we're getting down to crunch time, we actually have to buckle down.
Right,
so
right.
it was one of those, hey, come on, like.
Formal training.
No.
No formal training.
No.
So, as on the job training, pretty much. So, as you went, have you did any studying, you know, as you knew this is what you were going to do and you're going to continue to do this? And so, have you sought, you know, any advice from anyone?
Not until this year did I actually start purchasing books
right.
on theater. Other than that, or before that, none.
Wow. That's such a natural talent right there.
Speaking of, like, if I had to say, it would remind me of the parable of the talents, Al.
Right.
You know, he gave his servants, like five, one servant five, another servant two,
right.
and then one servant one.
Right.
And it's just like, if he gave me three, then I'll take those three and I'll find three more. You know, like
right,
I'll get
right.
three more.
Not a Ponzi scheme. Like,
no. But it's just the whole using. And like, for instance, my talent is writing.
Right.
But I do poetry. I write books. I write songs. You know, I do so many things with just
right.
that one talent of writing. And it's by the grace of God, of course, because, I mean, of no merit of my own, but I definitely...
You know what I'm asking next? So you open that Pandora's box. You gotta give at least one stanza.
No.
We're gonna go to break, and when we come back, we'll give you a chance to think about this. We're gonna go to break. When we come back, Neicey Ford-Chatman gonna give us a stanza from one of her poems. We'll be back.
Yo, how you feel, brother?
Feeling good.
You feel good?
Feeling good.
Play so much bone, brother. How you feel, man?
I feel all right.
I'll call your name. I don't want no people to know you're in here.
Yeah.
How you feel, brother?
Right.
Hey, yeah. Sure getting down. Look at him. Ha. We're gonna have.
Back with Artist Spotlight. As promised, before we took our break, Neicey Ford-Chatman is going to give us some stanza from one of her poems.
I've fallen and I have failed, but I am not the only one. Now maybe I'm the first to stand before you, blemished, tarnished, stained, less than perfect, and still not be ashamed. I've fallen and I have failed, but I am not the only one. My past is just that. It's precedent, long ago, times of yore, an earlier period of what went before, ancient times, history. But there will always be his stories and her stories. Those who want to be the first to publicize my wrongs. Those who think they're doing the world as well as God a public service by telling them who I used to be and what I used to do. But I interrupt this public service announcement with a very important message, and that is this. Who cares about what the world thinks of me? You see, God, he already knows me. And still, he chose me.
There you have it right there. I got what I asked for, and they so did they. Neicey Ford-Chatman, playwright, poet, author, mother, wife, rapper, perhaps. Join us again for another episode of Artist Spotlight. I'm your host, Wallace Garner III.
Shining the wood with your jeans and the denim. Don't worry, it's hip hop. Don't have a money earning concern. And I'll be teaching and learning. Hip hop for my rhymes and my love. Not for worry, no solution, no remedy. Feel like it's the
thinking. That dream is over. You gotta sit in. Tell all of you.